My name is Kurt Ransohoff. I'm the CEO at Sansum Clinic, and I would like to welcome you all to our town hall meeting. As you know, there is a lot in the news right now about Obamacare and exchanges and filibusters and government shutdowns over health care. And I can't tell you how delighted I am to say that we will discuss none of that today. Today we will actually talk about health care, and we won't talk about health care politics or health care policy. Some of those issues are important, though, and if you have any questions, I will linger over there somewhere at the end of the good meeting, and I'll be available to answer any questions that you might have. I'll be available to take any questions. I'm not sure I have a lot of answers. As you all know, October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, and we are pleased to participate in a campaign to increase awareness. National Bra Day, which I must say is an interesting name, was last week, and the focus was on the team approach to breast care. There was a national forum in Florida, and very much like ours, but we are very fortunate to have a comprehensive team right here in our own community, and these panelists are part of that. So let's get started. I'd first like to start by just introducing a couple of people. We have Bobbie Rosenblatt and Julie Nadel from the Women's Council of Sansum Clinic. Maybe you guys could just indicate your existence. They're really the dynamic duo. They've arranged a number of these town hall meetings and have arranged many of the other fun events that Sansum Clinic has put on. So we thanks to them. And you may also notice that Julie, and I will not forget Jack, Nadel, donated generously to make this nice lobby. Roberta Williams, I think, is here today. Roberta runs this building, in which she has to supervise more than 40 physicians. There's Roberta over there with her flak jacket. As I mentioned, she supervises more than 50 exceptionally calm and cooperative doctors who have no opinions on any of the things about how things should be done. On top of that, Roberta also supervises about 200 employees, so we thank her for her hard work. We have Vicki Hazard, who is the chair of our volunteer board of trustees. We have Beth Voss, I see here as well, who is also one of our board members. Rick Scott is here, who is the president of the Cancer Foundation. And I haven't seen Silvana. Are you here? Oh, well, we were hoping that Silvana would be here, but as you all know, Silvana Kelly is the executive director of the Breast Cancer Resource Center, and if she comes, you can say hello to her. So we want to thank all of them for all they do to support breast care in our community. I'd also like to acknowledge Ron Latimer, who's not here with us today. Dr. Latimer was very involved in getting this meeting together and just is worthy of mentioning. I'd really like to take a moment and just acknowledge Mentor, who is our town hall sponsor. Mentor was one of the two title sponsors, Union Bank was the other, for the gala that we had in May of this year with Jay Leno at the Rusak Estate. That was an incredibly successful and fun program that raised more than $1.2 million for cancer programs and services in this community. We are delighted to have Mentor participate in their town hall meeting. Mentor is a worldwide leader in implant technology, and breast reconstruction is one of the final pieces in the breast care continuum. We have a couple of people I'd just like to mention. David Wilson, the worldwide president, is here. David, thank you. As is Francesca DiMartino, and Francesca is the Director of Worldwide Communications, and Gary Choi, the Director of U.S. Marketing, is here as well. So I'm honored to serve today as the moderator for this event. My staff likes to give me very important tasks, which they trust that I could do, which is to point out where the bathrooms are. They are right over there. I'd also like to just remind everyone to please turn off your cell phone. The other task I get to do is to remind our speakers, all of whom could speak for an hour or more on any of the subjects, that to limit their talks to 5 minutes, just because we want to have everybody have a chance, and we want to have a chance for you all to ask questions at the end of their talk. You know, breast cancer is a disease that really, as the expression goes, that takes a village. It is a condition that requires all variety of experts, and we have many of them here today. The purpose of this town hall is to outline the full continuum of breast care available to the patients in our community, from prevention and genetic testing through diagnosis, treatment, and reconstruction. So let me introduce our esteemed panel. I'll tell you more about them later. We have Dr. Kathy Pojunas from Radiology. Kathy's here. Rosa Choi is from the Department of Surgery. Tammy Stockero is an RN who runs the Breast Care Navigator Program. Danielle Sharaga is the genetic counselor. Warren Suh is a radiation oncologist. Fred Kass is a medical oncologist. And the guy who's not here, but who will be here, is Wesley Schooler, who is a plastic surgeon. I was mentioning that the problem with inviting surgeons to anything is that they tend to say things like, I'm in the operating room and can't get out. So we hope that Dr. Schooler will show up not bloody later in the meeting. So let me kick off the discussion navigating the breast care continuum with Kathy Pojunas, and let me tell you a moment about Kathy. Kathy has been a radiologist in Santa Barbara for 26 years, I think. Sorry. She started when she was 10.
Exactly.
She works both at Sansum Clinic and at Cottage Hospital. She specializes in neuroradiology, MRI, and breast imaging and mammography in particular. Kathy got her medical degree at UCLA. Well done there, I will unbiasedly state. Then Kathy went to the cold of Wisconsin to do her internship and residency at the Medical College of Wisconsin, where she was ultimately a neuroradiology fellow and assistant professor of radiology. Fortunately for all of us, Kathy decided that it was better to be in warm Southern California and came back. I also should just point out that Kathy is a breast cancer survivor herself, so she does have a particularly unique perspective on this topic. So the question that I'm going to give you inadequate time to address is, there are so many choices for breast imaging right now. What should women do for breast imaging?
The answer is get a mammogram. Mammography is the only screening modality that's been proven to decrease. It's the only screening modality that's been proven to decrease breast cancer mortality. And since widespread screening got started in the late 1980s, the mortality rate from breast cancer has dropped by approximately 30%. And about 75% of that drop is really attributed to screening and early detection, and the remainder secondary to improvements in treatment. So mammography, definitely, and the recommendation from the American Cancer Society and the American College of Radiology, the AMA, the Society of Breast Imaging, is you get a mammogram annually beginning at age 40 with no upper limits of age. Stop screening depending upon the individual person. Part and parcel of that, I just kind of want to touch about breast density. Some of you in the audience might have already received letters about this when you come in for your annual mammogram. There's a law that went into effect in California in April of this year that all women have to be informed if they have, quote, dense breast, meaning that more than 50% of their breast tissue, of their breast or breast tissue rather than fatty tissue. We're not alone. There are multiple other states that have adopted this legislation. About 38% of women in the U.S. now live in areas where that legislation is in effect. So what do? I mean, the letter tells you you have dense breast. It says you should consult your doctor about additional screening methods because mammography may be limited in that situation. So you do need to contact your doctor because it's all about risk. There are other modalities out there that can be used to evaluate your breast, but not everybody needs to have those done, and that's a discussion you need to have with your doctor, and you can decide what the best approach would be for you.
Okay, thank you. By the way, Dr. Schooler, as you didn't notice, has arrived. Thank you. And did not show up bloody from the OR, so we particularly thank you for that. The next up is going to be Dr. Rosa Choi. Rosa is the chair of the Department of Surgery here at Sansum. Also got her MD at UCLA, and then did her residency in general surgery at Harvard University Massachusetts General Hospital. She was instrumental, along with a number of people up at the here with us today, in the formation of the Breast Cancer Alliance, group here in Santa Barbara, which is a group of surgeons, medical oncologists, radiation oncologists, radiologists, pathologists, and plastic surgeons to deliver a multi-specialty approach to caring for women with breast cancer. So Rosa, the question I'd like to ask you is, there many women are facing breast cancer and are having to decide a very important question, which is, will a mastectomy save my life? And maybe you could address that.
So, Kurt, the answer to that question is, yes, a mastectomy can save your life, but I also want to say that a partial mastectomy can also save your life. So I think it's really important for women to understand when an individual has a cancer diagnosis, a woman really has two choices, and it's the decision between her treating physicians and the woman about what's the best option for her. And I think as a healthcare provider or as a breast surgeon, I feel it's my job to guide the patient with breast cancer diagnosis what is the best option for her. Now, in the last decade, there's been an increase in rates of mastectomy, and for a couple of reasons, really. I think what I want to touch upon is, why is there an increased risk or increased rate of mastectomy over the last decade, and why would a woman choose to have a mastectomy over a partial mastectomy? So partial mastectomy is the same terminology as a lumpectomy, and oftentimes we don't feel lumps anymore, so we use partial mastectomy. The mastectomy rate in the early 2000s was probably as low as it could be, which was about 33%, and now it's gone up to 38%. And two main reasons why we see a rise is, number one, we have now, as Danielle will discuss, increased awareness about the genetic aspect of breast cancer and ovarian cancer. So when you increase awareness, I think you capture the population that are at high risk and test them for genetic mutations. And once they're identified, we have women who choose to have prophylactic mastectomy. So I think that's one reason why that's increase in rate. Not only prophylactic, which was 4%, but over the last decade also has risen to 11%. The second reason is, I think, technology-driven. When you have technology, and what I mean by that is imaging technology of the breast, like MRI and ultrasound, and more experience with it, we're able to identify what we call occult lesions. Small lesions that may have not been detected at the time 20 years ago when a woman had a cancer diagnosis and treatment, but had a little spot, same breast, that no one knew about, but patient had care of her primary breast cancer with chemotherapy and radiation, and that probably took care of the occult cancer. Now we're able to see it and identify it, and I think not only on the side that the diagnosis of breast cancer is made, but on the other side. And oftentimes that leads women to want to have decisions about mastectomy and prophylactic mastectomy. So I think some of that is technology driven. So I think it's important for women to understand, and the best analogy I could give is, I tell the women, if you have an identical twin sister and you both have the same cancer, and one person has a mastectomy and the other person has a partial mastectomy with the understanding that they would need to have radiation therapy, their survival is the same. And I think when you put it into that perspective, that fear of recurrence and that fear of dying from that diagnosis can somewhat be alleviated so that they can make choices about breast conservation. I think that's it.
Okay, that's great. I'd like next to introduce Tammy Stockero, who is a breast care navigator. Tammy got her nursing degree here locally at City College. She's done many things at the Cancer Center and is so good at everything that she does that, unfortunately, we just keep heaping more responsibility upon her. She has been at the Cancer Center since 2010. Among her duties now is heading up the Breast Care Navigator program, which was the first established here in 2010. We now have three breast care navigators on staff. The navigator serves as a liaison between patients and various healthcare providers and departments, providing everything from breast health education and prevention to treatment and survivorship. So we're really fortunate to have this level of service in our community. So Tammy, the question is, I've told everybody how lucky we are to have a breast care navigator program, but maybe you could say, what does a breast care navigator do?
Okay, in 5 minutes or less, right?
Yes.
So I guess the best way to answer that is I'll start with my job description. And the first line of my job description says that the navigator is a consistent care coordinator throughout the continuum of care. So what does that mean? It means that I'm fortunate enough to get to work with the whole team here. I get to meet patients at time of diagnosis, hopefully, and help them understand, as Dr. Choi talked about, their decisions. They get to make decisions with their healthcare providers about partial mastectomy versus mastectomy. What is radiation? What is chemo? What is my likely plan of care or path that I will take? And how much decision do they have in that? So I get to educate them, share with them evidence-based information, national standards, and really coordinate the visits with the other providers so maybe they can meet with Dr. Suh first to find out what radiation is about before they make that decision, to coordinate the appointment with Dr. Schooler to talk about reconstruction, with a medical oncologist to talk about an aromatase inhibitor for 5 years. So a lot of what we do is education. A huge part of our role, and one of my favorite parts, is just the emotional support. When a patient is diagnosed with cancer, any cancer, including breast cancer, you can imagine the anxiety and the uncertainty that comes with that. So as navigators, we get to be their contact person. I get to be their go-to person that, you know, who should I call? Should I call my surgeon? Should I call my medical oncologist? And so I get to be the one that takes those calls and helps them figure out who to call next or what's next and what questions they need to ask in order to make decisions for their journey. We have a lot of resources we offer patients. I get to help them figure out what those are. We have a social services department that helps with insurance, transportation, counseling. I connect patients with that. Our wellness program, which was supported by the gala as well, we have fitness and strength programs through Santa Barbara Athletic Club and YMCA. We have so many classes for patients going through this journey, everything from knitting to glider rides and massage. And anyway, I could go on and on about our wellness classes. But part of my role is making sure that the patients know those classes are there. They're free of charge. They're available to patients going through this as well as family and caregivers. So we get to work them through. We get to help them find those resources during treatment and then as they enter into survivorship and transition back to their new normal.
That's great. Your colleague will go next. And that is Danielle Sharaga, who is a genetic counselor. Danielle is actually the newest member of our team. I think she just joined us in January, where she came from the Queen's Genetic Center in Honolulu as a prenatal, adult, and cancer genetic counselor. She specializes in genetic counseling. Many of her patients have a personal and family history of breast cancer. I should just point out that the Cancer Center and Sansum Clinic have been doing genetic counseling since 1999. So what I'd like to ask you, Danielle, is just tell us, what does a genetic counselor do? And just share that with us, please.
Yeah, so a genetic counselor is a health professional trained in genetics and genetic counseling. And you usually work as part of a team or in some sort of potential multidisciplinary setting or just working with your community to help families or patients that might have a genetic condition known in the family or might be at risk to have that. So in the cancer setting, usually it's the latter, usually don't know that there's something in the family, but there's enough going on that makes, you know, the patient or the physician question whether or not there could be something hereditary. So I work with those families and patients to try to assess, you know, how likely is it that there is something hereditary? Most of the time, cancer is not hereditary. And so sometimes my job is providing reassurance that genetic testing really isn't necessary in this setting. But if it is, then we'll talk about why and how that could be helpful, if this is the right time for the patient to pursue that type of thing. The type of families that I typically see, the features that, you know, their physicians or patients are looking for are usually, you know, multiple cancers in the family, usually the same cancers. So in this setting, maybe like multiple breast cancers in the family. Or maybe the patient is the only one in the family, but they were diagnosed at a relatively early age, so maybe less than 50 or 45, and they have breast cancer. Another thing we'd look for when trying to see if someone should actually talk to a genetic counselor would be if there's any unusual cancers in the family. So ovarian cancer in the setting of breast cancer, sometimes those can be related when you see ovarian cancer in a family. And breast cancer, or even just ovarian cancer alone, is a reason to talk to a physician about potentially thinking about genetic assessment. So those are the main things that we look for. Sometimes ancestry is also important. So patients of Eastern European Jewish ancestry, if they have a family history of any breast or ovarian cancer in their family, they're certainly people that can talk to their doctors about the need for genetic counseling or testing.
So just a real quick question. The Angelina Jolie situation, did that increase your demand quite a bit?
Initially, I certainly think that it increased the demand. I will say, since I did my graduate training in Pittsburgh and then I worked in Hawaii, so this is the third community I've been in, and I would say even an academic center that I was in Pittsburgh, this community is very, admirable for the referrals that we were getting before that. They're really good referrals, and they continued to be good referrals. I wasn't getting very many patients that were saying, you know, my great-grandma had breast cancer, 90, do I need to come in because of Angelina Jolie? So I think we were already doing a really great job with breast cancer, and that only continued to add to people asking good questions.
So smart doctors and smart patients.
Yeah, very.
You heard it here. So going next will be Warren Suh. Dr. Suh is a radiation oncologist and the medical director of radiation oncology. He completed his undergraduate studies at Cornell and then participated in a joint MD, Masters of Public Health program through Harvard University School of Public Health and the University of Chicago Pritzker School of Medicine. He then completed his residency at the University of Michigan. Dr. Suh is the Vice Chair of Radiology and Head of Radiation Oncology at Cottage Hospital. And I should mention that Dr. Suh is very active on the national level in radiation oncology. So Warren, radiation oncology is always seems like a mystery to many of us, even doctors, frankly. Help us out and tell us, does every patient need radiation therapy?
Right, so the simple answer is no, and the complicated answers, no, as well. But starting off the bat, I've learned over the years that it's best to start off with two apologies when I see patients. One, I tell my patients, I'm sorry that you have to deal with the word cancer. The second apology I make is that I'm sorry you have to now deal with the word radiation on top of the cancer word. Two are rightfully fear-striking words in anyone's mind and heart. And so our consultation time is set aside for 90 minutes at our cancer center just to spend the appropriate amount of time in reviewing the pros and cons of what radiation is all about. But to make a long story short, I want to bring up an analogy. I always emphasize a team approach. I mean, we're fortunate in this community, as you see our panel here, there's physicians of many different specialties, surgery, medical oncology, radiation oncology present. And I just went through a remodeling in our house, and you know, there was an electrician, carpenter, and plumber. And to explain each of our own roles, I said, you know, Dr. Choi is like the carpenter, and I'm like the electrician, and Dr. Kass is the plumber.
You didn't count on the fact I'm speaking, yeah?
Right, I thought the seating arrangement was going to be otherwise. But I drive that point home mainly because we each have our own areas of expertise, and mine being radiation. And we talk to each other. We come up with a team approach. And at the end of the day, to ultimately the answer to the question, does everyone need radiation? Simple answer again is no. Complicated answer is no. As a standard of care, patients should get radiation after partial mastectomy to optimize their chances of being cured and to live a longer life free of cancer. However, there are small subset of patients for whom the recurrence rates are so low that partial mastectomy is enough and adequate, and you do not need radiation to follow. It's been an active area of research within our field. This group of patients are being identified through published literature, ongoing literature, so it's definitely a worthy goal, and we meet with our patients to decide if that individual patient is in this right category. So at the end of the day, though, I do leave with a motto: think of radiation as healing rays, not just radiation. And with that, I'll pass on to my very able colleague, the plumber.
Well, Dr. Kass is up next, and Dr. Kass is a number of things, actually including an attorney, but I wasn't aware that you were a plumber, although Fred, we do have some serious issues at our house that you could help out with. Dr. Kass is the Director of Research and Wellness at the Cancer Center. Fred went to medical school at Tufts after really truly being a practicing attorney in Washington, D.C. After Tufts, he did his residency in internal medicine at Yale New Haven Hospital and fellowship in medical oncology at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute in Boston. I will just share that Fred is actually the first person I met in Santa Barbara. My wife and I moved into our house right next to Fred, and that was 22 years ago, and we've been friends since, and I certainly am delighted to get to work with him now. Fred is the clinical assistant professor of medicine at the USC School of Medicine as well. So, Fred, one of the most complicated decisions facing women with breast cancer is the role of chemotherapy or hormonal therapy. Does every woman need chemotherapy or hormonal therapy, and how do we decide?
So like Warren, I think the short answer is no, and the complicated answer is no. And it's interesting to look back because you'll start to pick up the theme as you listen to all of us as to kind of the general direction where cancer care is going. We're trying to accomplish more with less. We're trying to just be smarter at how we do it. And it's interesting to look back. If you go back to Johns Hopkins Hospital around 1900, now Kurt's starting to get nervous because he's thinking, how will Fred get from 1900... to 2013 in 5 minutes.
Plumber like you, man.
So Johns Hopkins was kind of the center of the medical universe around the turn of that century. William Osler, whose name is familiar to all of us in internal medicine, kind of established kind of how we see patients, was professor of medicine there. And there was a surgeon by the name of Halsted, who in breast cancer circles became really associated with Halsted radical mastectomy, but who in his time really was head of a department that made enormous strides. Some of the early surgeries were first performed there, the first hernia surgery, the first gallbladder surgery. In fact, there's a myth, maybe it's true, maybe Rosa, it's true, there's a myth that Halsted performed the first gallbladder surgery on his mother on the... Yeah, okay. But what Halsted did then is he, with a very able team, developed a very radical surgery for breast cancer, which involved removal of the breast with a cancer, removal of lymph nodes, removal of underlying muscle. When we look back on that, certainly by our standards, it's a horribly extensive and has been in many women a debilitating surgery. Yet at the time, in 1900, it actually represented a very thoughtful, innovative approach to surgery. That surgery remained kind of the dominant surgery in this country through the 1970s. And the thought was that by taking more tissue, we would reduce the risk of recurrence, that breast cancer somehow grew in a methodical way. It started off as a small cancer, it grew to a larger cancer, it spread into adjacent tissues. It marched along in the same way that a group of people would walk down a beach. And in fact, that was a misconception about the disease, and it was the reason why women unfortunately later developed recurrences of breast cancer in other parts of the body, notwithstanding that extensive surgery. And what Dr. Halsted and his group were missing, and actually wasn't really understood for several more decades, was that cancer could spread, not in that kind of methodical walking down the beach way, but could get into the bloodstream and spread systemically as microscopic amounts of disease. When that concept was finally understood, and when the idea of systemic therapy finally gained some foothold, we realized that there could be a system whereby after surgery, we administered some sort of systemic treatment that cleaned up all that microscopic disease. And as we better appreciated that, two things happened. One is we aided the process by which we were steadily doing less surgery than we were before, to the point that we now talk about partial mastectomies. And more importantly, we appreciated that the way to cure breast cancer was after surgery, to figure out effective ways to clean up any microscopic disease that may have escaped in the circulation. And around 1990, I think, was probably the high point of that process, and we as medical oncologists were sure that just about every woman benefited from some amount of chemotherapy and some amount of hormonal therapy. And then we got smarter. Not right away, but we gradually got smarter, and we realized that just as Halstead had probably overreached with surgery, so we were probably overreaching with systemic therapy, that not all women needed chemotherapy, not all women needed hormonal therapy. And what has greatly advanced this process is our sense of molecular biology. We now understand that breast cancer is a collection of really heterogeneous diseases. And as we have better technology for splitting these breast cancers into the individual diseases that they are, where we have the better ability to understand that two women ostensibly coming in with what looks altogether like exactly the same breast cancer may have completely different diseases with completely different therapies. So we've been able to develop molecular biologic techniques to distinguish who really needs chemotherapy, who really needs hormonal therapy, who will benefit, who won't. Today, we looked at, shortly before this meeting, a conference call in which we were trying to look at who needs 10 years of hormonal therapy, who needs 5, who needs none. So I think that over time, I think that aided by a lot of terrific underlying basic science, we're not only better doctors in the sense of being able to cure more patients, but I think we're smarter doctors in the sense of being able to maintain those cure rates, increase those cure rates, and at the same time give patients only the therapy they really need.
Great, thank you. Our final speaker before questions is Dr. Wesley Schooler. Thanks for coming. Dr. Schooler is a board certified in plastic surgery, general surgery, and hand surgery. Yet another overachiever up here. He is an expert in breast reconstructive surgery and breast cosmetic surgery. He received his medical degree from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, where he also completed his training in general surgery and critical care. He then did his residency in plastic surgery at the University of California at San Francisco. He has extensive experience in breast microsurgical techniques. And Dr. Schooler is an expert in performing special breast reconstructive procedures that were not available in Santa Barbara prior to his arrival. He has contracted with Sansum Clinic to take care of our patients. So, Dr. Schooler, when should a patient consult a reconstructive surgeon?
First, sorry for being late and wearing pajamas to the meeting. We have a 3-week-old at home, so first-time dad, so things are a little disheveled. The short answer is a plastic surgeon should be involved, and it should be a multidisciplinary team, as you see here. At all the places I trained and worked all along, at the academic centers, Chapel Hill, UCSF, and my first job at Oregon Health Sciences, and then at USC, we always had a multidisciplinary team and a lot of good communication to come up with a comprehensive, plan to show the patient so they can make a good decision on lumpectomy, partial mastectomy, radiation or not, and all the factors there. So I always felt like that was that was needed. In the medical legally in the 90s, they decided that breast reconstruction was
you know, necessary and what and insurances would have to help cover it at least. And then more recently, they decided that contralateral symmetry was also included, and so that gave women a lot of options. As Dr. Kass mentioned, you know, as breast cancer surgery evolved over the last 100 years, so has reconstructive surgery with the newer techniques. And so there are a lot of different options. There's implants, there's using your own body tissue with minimal morbidity to the donor site. And so there's a lot of different options. And really, before making the final decision, you should have a plastic surgeon available. Great.
Okay, great. Thank you. We'll take some questions, but before that, I do just want to acknowledge, really, when you kind of go through the people's bios here, it really is impressive, the quality of doctors that we have, and the quality of doctors that we have, and others up here. So, round of applause. So, we will take questions, if anyone has any. Julie.
Dr. Kass, do you ever treat patients for breast cancer without surgery?
The question is, do we ever treat patients with breast cancer without surgery? And yes, I think in general, this always has been and remains first and foremost a surgical disease. We do sometimes see a subset of patients who have other medical issues that make surgery and anesthesia quite hazardous, and if we're really lucky, those women have breast cancers that are amenable to simple hormonal therapy, and so we have occasionally tried to substitute hormonal therapy. The other thing is, which would essentially be a pill to take every day as a way to manage that. Ultimately, you know, sometimes I think the Dr. Choi and her colleagues help us out sometimes by finding surgical procedures that may not be optimal, but which are adequate. And so the answer is, in individual cases, somehow we'll make it work.
A body.
If you're diagnosed with breasts that are dense, is it harder then to detect if there is a tumor dense?
So the question was, if you have dense breasts, does that make it harder to diagnose whether or not a breast cancer is present? Let's let Dr. Pojunas take a initial.
Yes, it does, because the breast tissue tends to be white on a mammogram. The fat is black. The cancers also look white. So it's sort of been, the analogy has been made, you're looking sort of for a sheep in a snowstorm. It can be difficult. So in that particular situation, mammography may not be as effective as it is in the woman who has average density breast or fatty breast. Now, as I mentioned earlier, this kind of needs to be taken into account with your risk factors for breast cancer also. If you have dense breast and you have a consultation with your physician and your risk is felt to be increased, that's more than, say, 15 to 20% risk of breast cancer, then what's being recommended would be a breast MRI. Generally, the recommendation is out there. If you have dense breasts, you have risk factors that place you 20% risk or greater, or as Danielle can attest, you have some underlying genetic problem, I think the recommendations are for mammography and MRI. That can help you out. Now, what if you're just the woman with dense breasts and you're kind of in that intermediate risk category? There's really no good recommendation out there right now. And again, that's a discussion that needs to happen between you and with your physician. And what a lot of women are doing, we're offering, is breast ultrasound in that particular situation. I mean, breast ultrasound has been shown to increase the cancer detection rate. With the mammography alone, we usually see about 3 to 4 cases per 1,000 mammograms we look at. If we do ultrasound, it can go up to 6 to 8 cases per 1,000. And there tend to be small cancers and early cancers that are easily treatable. So that information out there relates from physicians, though, holding a transducer and doing handheld ultrasound and taking about 20 minutes per exam. So there are some automated machines out there. Sansum has one. And the early data suggests that may be just as good as doing the handheld ultrasound, but I think more data needs to come in, but that is an alternative screening method.
Yes.
No.
So the question.
Good. Let me repeat the question. Do dense breasts only occur in women over 40? The answer is no. Generally, the younger you are, the denser your breasts are. And in most postmenopausal women, you tend to lose breast density, but not always. I mean, there are 60, 70-year-old women out there who still have dense breasts.
Yes.
What about fibrocystic breast disease?
I'm going to give this to Dr. Choi.
The question was fibrocystic breast disease. Is that the same as breast dense breasts?
So the answer is no. Dense breast tissue is purely a radiographic term. So that is not by physical exam or pathologic diagnosis. Dense breast tissue is determined by a radiologist like Dr. Pojunas looking at a mammogram and grading that mammogram reading as dense or not dense. Fibrocystic disease is really a pathologic diagnosis, and that means a breast biopsy is done and a pathologist looks under the microscope for certain characteristics. There's such a potpourri of terminologies that fit into that fibrocystic disease. And so that's not even a clinical exam. It's not. Some women come to me and say, oh, I have really lumpy breasts, I have fibrocystic disease, and it's sort of wrong use of terminology just because they're not aware. But that's a pathologic diagnosis, usually from a breast biopsy, and it's benign. Hopefully that answered it.
Good. Yes.
With the genetics, if you're Eastern European background and you have breast cancer in your family, but people are older than 40 or how do you know at what point there's a risk for you to get this?
Yeah.
So that was a complicated question, Danielle. Can you repeat it?
Sure.
Because I'm not sure I could.
So I think you were asking, and I may not have mentioned it earlier, but it's Eastern European Jewish ancestry that's particularly important in this situation. So Eastern European ancestry is not a factor that matters for assessment, but Eastern European Jewish or Ashkenazi Jewish ancestry. So if you're of that ancestry, but the breast cancers in your family are older than 50, how do you know if it's something you need to think about, correct?
Right.
Okay. So any first, second, or third degree relative with breast cancer, doesn't matter their age, talk to your physician or genetic counselor about that. The chance of having so the most common cause of hereditary breast cancer is caused by genes, problems in genes called BRCA 1 and 2. And that's the gene of interest with Ashkenazi Jewish ancestry. And if you are just Ashkenazi Jewish and don't have a family history at all of cancer, you have about a 2% chance to have one of those gene changes. So most likely you don't. But if you add anyone in your family with breast cancer into the equation, then it goes up and it's, you know, worth thinking about.
Maybe it might be where I said I wouldn't talk about politics or policy, but it might be worth just mentioning one of the issues around that test is the cost. And maybe you could just shed some light on that.
Yeah. That particular test is not too expensive because you only need to look at three parts of the gene for Jewish ancestry. So that's about $500, and most insurance will cover that. But when you're looking at the entire gene like you have to look at in any other ancestry, that used to cost $4,000, but there's a lot of labs now that you can do the test for about $2,000, which is still very expensive for most people. So your copay, if you have an HMO, usually if you meet criteria, you've been assessed, shouldn't have to worry about payment for that. It's covered by most insurance policies. If you have a PPO, that's still a reasonable copay that you might be paying, but a lot of labs are doing it for about $100 if you have insurance and meet criteria.
That was actually a Supreme
Court. The copay, not the whole test.
That price came down because of a Supreme Court decision in which the court said that, you know, genes are not something that can be owned or patented, I believe. Yes?
I was recently diagnosed with breast cancer, had a mastectomy. Lymph nodes were clear, had an oncogenics test was a 1.5 centimeter, and chemotherapy is being considered. I had breast cancer 19 years ago at the same breast. My understanding, if your lymph nodes are clear, then there's a possibility still that there could be some, that would be the oncologist, Dr. Kossica.
Yes.
Could be some stray risk out there somewhere in the body, and that's why chemo is being considered.
Yeah, I think that when I first started to train, we had a very, we had a very binary, very simple approach, which was if lymph nodes were positive, we recommended chemotherapy. If lymph nodes were negative, we didn't. And then over time, we came to understand that the precise size of a breast cancer, or whether one lymph node was involved or not, or whether two lymph nodes were involved or not, was not as critical to predicting behavior as underlying biology. What was the tumor kind of molecularly programmed to do? Was it kind of programmed in a way that would be sensitive to chemotherapy? Was it programmed in a way that would create a risk for microscopic disease? And it turns out that those molecular factors are independent of the things we can easily look at, independent of size, independent of lymph node status. So we have patients with very small breast cancers and no involvement of lymph nodes, and we understand from testing these tumors molecularly that it would be very appropriate to administer chemotherapy to those patients. And then we have other patients with larger breast cancers and lymph node involvement, and we look at those molecularly. And somewhat counterintuitively, at least from the way we used to think when I first started, counterintuitively, in fact, chemotherapy isn't indicated at all. So the whole point of tests like Oncotype DX are to look past, we're kind of trying to not judge things quite so clearly as to try not to judge things simply on the basis of appearance, but trying to look at underlying molecular behavior. And tests like Oncotype DX are designed to unearth that hidden molecular information that tells us what really the right therapy is for an individual patient.
Yes.
First of all, I'd like to compliment the entire organization for getting together a wonderful alternative therapies treatment program for women either going through the surgery or doing the big three or what. And I think it's just really very exciting and heartening to know that being one of the women who has chosen not to have the chemotherapy and radiation. But I was wondering how far we are away from getting a doctor of oriental medicine to get into your team as well. Because of the fact, does that conflict to just, I mean, I heard it was anonymous, you know, but, you know, I was thinking to myself, there is some value, some merit to that in the therapy for some of the side effects. And for the people who ought not to take the big three plan, is it a possibility that you might consider something like that, bringing someone or a couple of people in various parts of the clinic, not just with the cancer, cancer treatment program, but
Thank you. The question, I think, was how open is the clinic to having more alternative approaches? And we are quite open to that. It's difficult because we need a certain amount of volume, you know, to bring that kind of program in. You would need to make sure that there's enough people who are going to utilize it that it makes sense and we can have it. So sometimes what we'll do is if there's not enough demand for us to have it ourselves, is we'll work with others who do offer that service.
so that if people are interested in pursuing that, we may refer them to another person who has the expertise and who has the volume to have a good program in that. But we don't close our mind to it. But guests, you have
a follow-up. Okay, well, I think, sorry to interrupt, but I just want to make sure. I'm just saying, just in terms of, you know, for insurance, that go outside.
Yeah. So that falls into the category of the things that we weren't going to talk about, but I'll venture in briefly. It's very challenging to figure out how to incorporate insurance into increasingly alternative choices. And that is something that is actually beyond our individual control. Are there any? Yes.
I'm unsure what effect radiation has on dense breast tissue. So how does it affect any future breast MRI or breast ultrasound?
That is a very good question. Did everybody hear the question? I think the question was, how does breast radiation affect breast tissue in terms of future diagnostic studies? Will it cause changes that will make future MRIs difficult or breast mammograms difficult? So that sounds like a Dr. Suh question to me.
I heard the word radiation, and I went, whoa, wait, that's me.
There was a glow.
All right. First, we don't make you glow. That is true. But breast radiation treatment has been a part of breast conservation approach. After partial mastectomy, you follow up with whole breast radiation. And the whole advantage of breast conservation is you obviously get to preserve your breasts. And going forward, as a part of that overall program, you do need to be monitored and imaged regularly to pick up any breast tumor recurrences that can arise in the breast where you had the cancer in the first place. As far as I know, and I'll defer to Pojunas for the details, there is no limitations in terms of being able to pick up breast cancers after you've had whole breast radiation. That's my limited knowledge, but I'll defer to Dr. Pojunas to elaborate.
Well, there are some changes that occur in your breast after having radiation therapy and after having surgery. So generally what's done is there's a baseline mammogram that's done after that. And then you might be imaged a little bit more frequently. Say, rather than every year, at 6 months. Yes. And again, that's I think you're kind of getting the theme of this, that a lot of the therapy management is going to be individually tailored. And what might be good for you in your situation might be to have an annual MRI in addition to the mammogram, whereas with another woman perhaps who has radiation therapy and doesn't have dense breast tissue, maybe she's not going to need that.
I think maybe some of the underlying question with the answer that you wanted to seek with was, does having radiation change your breast density?
Oh, so
the answer is no, because if you already have dense breast tissue, having radiation doesn't necessarily make it more challenging. And as Dr. Pojunas mentioned, most of the time if someone has breast conservation and they do the radiation, we do a 6 month post-radiation mammogram as sort of their new baseline. So over the years, and I think Dr. Pojunas and all of us who take care of women with breast cancer can attest to that, it doesn't change, it doesn't make it denser or less dense, having the radiation therapy. It's a new baseline. And one more point I want to make is that most of the time when women have had radiation on the affected breast and we do future imaging such as MRI, the problem site is never the site that was irradiated. That is quiet. It's usually the other side that still has the activity where biopsies may be needed. So if anything, it kind of quiets things down. It zaps everything, so to speak. And I think the answer is that no, it doesn't affect it in the future.
You know, I'd just like to ask a variation on that question for Dr. Schooler. And that is, are there things or decisions that women make early on that then can prevent them from having some sort of reconstructive surgery?
That prevent them from having...
So for instance, if a woman says, I'm going to have a mastectomy and then has radiation, does that make it more difficult or sometimes impossible to have reconstruction?
It doesn't make it, I mean, it doesn't make it impossible to have reconstruction. It means that you have to have other options, and there are more complicated procedures at times for that breast. But the ultimate goal for reconstruction is that you end up with symmetric breasts that you're happy with and you feel generally whole and that you've gotten beyond the problem. And so sometimes, you know, a lot of what I do is counsel them on the effects of lumpectomy radiation. They may go down one whole cup size on one breast, and they, you know, it may mean that they need to do something to the other breast, either lift or so we kind of go through all those different steps. And if the breast has been radiated, I know they don't like to hear me badmouth radiation because it, you know, on one hand, it's kept me in business for the last 10 years, but on the other hand, it's also the bane of my existence because of wound healing and infection and things. So it does make it trickier, but there are options either way. And I generally say, well, you need to be cured first, and then once we get beyond that, we can make you happy as far as how things look and in clothing and out, and there's a lot of options nowadays that we didn't have. So the first goal is get you cured, and then we decide, you know, how do we make everything even up to where you're happy and you feel comfortable.
Kurt,
yes.
Why do you sell the microphone? We are very grateful to Mentor and they are help. As a sponsor for the gallery event for the wellness community here. I have a question about these implants. Do you still use silicone implants, or are they all saline? Are there choices for women? And what have you counseled them for that direction?
So we... Everything's kind of gone full circle. As many people probably know, implants sort of started around Santa Barbara. They say this is the real Silicon Valley. all the companies started with Schulte, you know, with the medical grade silicone right nearby here. And now there are currently two companies in town here. The third is down in Orange County. In the early 90s, you know, the late 80s, early 90s, this big silicone scare came up, and implants were banned. And then ultimately, actually, the person who was the dean of the med school at UCSF when I was a resident had been the head of FDA when they banned the silicone implants. They turned around and found out after lots of studies that there wasn't any general medical problem like lupus and rheumatoid arthritis and all these other weird things that were coming from the silicone. Having said that, they've deemed that they were safe again. They reapproved them. They have changed the silicone consistency since then, but for the most part, things have gone back to silicone implants. In Europe, they never stopped using them, and they looked at women in Switzerland and different places, and they didn't have any increased incidence of any weird diseases. So we've kind of gone back to using more silicone implants. They're sturdier. They've done a lot of studies. The shell is stronger and sturdier. They don't cause any systemic disease. And the saline implants oftentimes give out at times and rupture over time, and then that doesn't cause any medical problem, but you end up having to have them replaced repeatedly. So we've kind of gone back to more often silicone. Occasionally I get maybe one in 50 or 100 women who's just uncomfortable from what they remember from an aunt back in the 80s or something, and they say, well, I just want saline anyway. So,
Yes.
I have a question on follow-up care after breast cancer treatment. That's probably directed to Dr. Kass. I'm just wondering, is it better for women to always continue their annual follow-up care with a medical oncologist or go like to their family physician? And very capable, part of your organization. But when I come to meetings like this and I see all the changes that have happened, even in the last 10 years, I'm wondering, should we every now and then go back to the medical oncologist, or what's your opinion on that?
So first of all, just from the standpoint of follow-up care, I think it's really important to point out that that part of the answer may come from me. Part of the answer should come from Tammy Stockero, because I think a lot of what she and her group are doing are focusing on the appropriate multidisciplinary care of cancer survivors, and that involves medical follow-up, it may involve surgical follow-up, it may involve lifestyle changes, that maybe as we gain more information about the role of diet and exercise in preventing new cancers or in limiting the risk of recurrence of cancers, that kind of stuff is as important, and some for some women more important than strictly speaking which doctor you happen to choose. In general, I think the most important thing is that women need a doctor, and a doctor with whom they have a good relationship, and if they're lucky, they're, you know, to be honest, in a community like this where there is a mature Navigator and survivorship program that can assist as well. In general, we try, from a medical oncology standpoint, we're trying to keep track of our patients, not necessarily to have those patients come in all the time to see us, but keep track of who they are. I think one of the most important innovations in this community is the clinic's acquisition of Epic as an electronic medical record system. This is going to allow us to keep track of women without necessarily having them come in all the time to see us. One of the pieces of data we're now looking at is the extent to which we need to do things to prevent late recurrences in general. And I don't want to create the impression that women have to worry about recurrences after year five. But the fact of the matter is, there are some subgroups of breast cancer where recurrences, although rarely, they do happen after year five. We have to have a way to follow those patients, and sometimes I think we're now developing information about how best to intervene to lower the risk of late recurrence in that small group of women who may be vulnerable. So the bottom line is, we want to keep you in the system. We want to know who you are, but there's no firm rule for which of us you have to see.
But it sounds like a good thing to take from this would be to check in with your Navigators every now and then and take it from there.
So Fred pretty much covered most of it, but I think when patients meet with me when they're done with treatment, we want to transition people back to their regular life, back to their primary care physicians, but we like to keep them close to us for 5-ish years, like Fred said, depending. So rather, you know, sometimes the surgeons want to see the patients every 3 months, and Dr. Saw wants to see them every 3 months, and Dr. Kass wants to see them every 3 months. So what we try to help them do is spread that out so that you're not seeing 3 doctors this month and 3, right? So spread that out throughout the year so that involved in that is your primary care physician and somebody who's doing a careful breast exam, whether that's your surgeon that you feel comfortable with or your primary or your gynecologist. And really just helping to establish what is follow-up care and who's going to do that. And for each person, depending on who their team is, that might look a little bit different.
I'll just comment on that. I'm a primary care doctor, and so sometimes it's actually really rewarding when the oncologist says, you don't need to come back to me anymore. Usually my experience is the patient feels great, not that they don't like you guys, but they feel great that they have sort of been graduated beyond that. I'll also point out that, as Fred mentioned, because we have one electronic shared record, I can see who did the breast exam and when the mammogram was done. And so, you know, all the mammograms are done by the same radiologist, no matter which doctor did them, and they all have the same recommendation, no matter which doctor did them. So I'll agree. Women seem to want to transition at different times and have different levels of comfort. Some are thrilled to be graduated from their oncologist, and some are scared to leave their oncologist, and they tend to follow for longer.
Yes.
I just wanted to clarify. I think, as Dr. Choi said something about when we have radiation, when radiation is confirmed, that will change the scheduling of the imaging of the cancer. In other words, in terms of precautions, is that right?
What I said was that oftentimes after a woman has completed radiation therapy for her breast cancer, the first new baseline mammogram on that side is a 6-month from the time that the radiation was completed. So that's just sort of the first mammogram on the affected side post-treatment.
And why is that?
And then you go back to a year. So it's just that first. And I think I don't know if there's any really good reason. It's what I grew up with. It's what I saw that was done. And I think doing it too soon would be maybe some changes residual from mammogram, from the surgery, and from the radiation. So we'd like to do things in 6 months, as you guys probably all know. Come back and see me in 6 months. So that's just sort of a new baseline on the affected side. Then you go back to once a year. Sorry, I didn't follow that. You know, I think that the important rule is once a year. Get your mammogram once a year.
Sounds like that's a very specific question.
On both sides.
There's no right answer, but I can tell you, having been on faculty at the other Harvard Hospital, not Mass General, where Dr. Choi was at, but at Dana-Farber Brigham and Women's Hospital, the first mammogram was done typically 6 months to 1 year on the irradiated breast, and then you resume your one-year cycle. That's just the way they did it over there. Now that I'm also on faculty at UCLA, I can tell you UCLA has a different program. I mean, they mandate it at 6 months, and then they do it once a year. So even among major academic centers, there's slight variation. So there's no hard and fast rule. The general principle is you do want to get a breast imaging a bit earlier than 1 year out for the breast where you had the breast cancer treated. And for the opposite breast, you should resume getting imaged and screened once a year.
So, in other words, that breast, it does have something to do with the fact that you have radiation, but we determine that it has to be seen quickly because it could affect the cancer or if there is any breast.
No, I mean, I think it's because it's the site that had the cancer, so we do want to get an image earlier than the 1 year out. So, I mean, there's no, again, there are rough guidelines, and I think we try to adhere to that. And even among academic centers, there are some variations. So as long as I think Dr. Choi has stated, get an imaging within the 1 year, you're good. And I guess the second point I'd like to emphasize too, plastic surgery has been a wonderful addition to the multidisciplinary care. And I can tell you that until about 5 years ago, even back in Boston, there was no plastic surgeon regularly attending the breast tumor board, but plastic surgeons are now a necessary and welcomed addition to the multidisciplinary care. And having someone like Dr. Skula in the community has really elevated our level of care, because certainly with radiation, we do a lot of things that I need to consult him with and figure out what he's planning to do, vice versa. So ultimately, at the end of the day, I think the more we interact, the more we talk amongst ourselves, the more we are able to have a gathering, which Sansum Clinic has supported wonderfully, as well as Cancer Center. It ultimately benefits the patients and ensures that the patients get the best of care with not just one mind, but two, three, four, actually, there's more than four, about five or six minds all put together. So at the end of the day, I think we have a great team assembled with a wonderful support from the clinic that enables patients to get the best care possible. That's, I would say, I'm proud of being able to be part of.
Let's take one more question, and then we'll move on to the food portion of the event.
I, too, would like to thank you all for giving of your time so generously to present such wonderful information to us, the public. I have a question for Dr. Sue, and that is, if a woman has a small tumor, as Dr. Choi said, resected like a lumpectomy, later she turns out to, and has radiation at that time, later she turns out to have a subsequent tumor, can you re-radiate that breast?
Good question. And if you've had the standard whole breast radiation after partial mastectomy, and the cancer were to recur, thankfully, the likelihood of this occurring is very low. unfortunately, it's not a zero event. So we do rarely see these types of clinical situations. The right thing to do at that point is to do breast mastectomy or mastectomy. Repeating every part of our body has a tolerance to radiation. When we give you the radiation the first time, it's not only effective, but it's safe both in terms of short-term side effects. It's also safe in terms of long-term side effects. But if we were to have to give radiation to a part of the body that received radiation before, the risk of side effects goes up. Hence, at that point, absolutely, you can still be cured. That's the main message of the day. And the way to be cured, standard of care, would be a mastectomy.
But not followed by radiation.
Right, not followed by radiation.
And my second question is there a residual amount of heat that builds up in the body way post-radiation?
Another good question. So this is a part where I get to tell patients, you don't get to glow because we don't leave any radioactive residue behind in your body. The type of radiation that you get for radiation treatment is external, which means the beam enters your body and leaves in a matter of nanoseconds. It's unlike other types of radiations you may hear about. For example, a patient with thyroid cancer, they do become radioactive, because you get radioactive material inserted into your system and you do have to be isolated in the hospital bed. But the radiation that you need for breast cancer is in your system literally a matter of nanoseconds. So when you're done with the radiation, there's no residue whatsoever, but your body's obviously healing and recovering from the fact that there was a path of radiation that went through your breast tissue.
Question I have for Dr. Schooler. You mentioned earlier that since your arrival here at Santa Barbara, we now have additional alternatives to breast reconstruction rather than just our implant choice. Could you briefly tell us about some of those? I know that we've moved from tram to the deep flap. Can you just briefly tell us about that? Because I don't know that many of us in the audience know about these options.
Sure. So when you reconstruct the breast, a whole breast, so a mastectomy reconstruction, there is implant-based reconstruction. Typically put an expander in, followed by a second stage implant. Occasionally put in an implant right away. And we oftentimes use this acellular dermis or alloderm or one of these dermal products. The other alternative is using your own body tissue. If we know for sure that you're not going to get radiated, then doing a flap, i.e. taking part of your own body, even either muscle or fat and tissue, are alternatives. And there, you know, in the early 80s, the tram flap came about, and that was basically taking your lower abdominal pannus and your rectus muscle staying attached, tunneling it up and bringing it up to the chest. And that evolved in the 90s to the DIEP flap or deep flap that meant we could basically trace little blood vessels from the fat in your lower tummy down through the rectus muscle and just take off the fat and occasionally a little bit of muscle and then bring that up to the chest, sew it back in, leave your rectus muscle intact, which recovers over the following year. And so that became very popular, and that is, for most of us who can do microsurgery, that's our first choice. I really don't like the residual effects on the abdomen of doing the old tram flap. And having done some of both, I've seen a difference. The other options were, there was one called a gap flap where you could use part of your buttock. I don't typically recommend or do that one. That one was sort of tried in multiple places, and there's still people who do it, but there's some residual effects. And there's an inner thigh flap we can do, which I did one of those here a few months ago, and the lady was really happy. She was really tiny, didn't have any abdomen. I think she was a Sansum patient, actually, and she's really happy with it. We have to kind of symmetrize it, so we took a chunk of her inner thigh and made a breast out of it without any residual effects. So that's another option. So there are a lot of different options that we have now besides just...
Can I say that, please? Do you find with that heat level a better outcome, perhaps, or a good choice for women who have had radiation? Let's say they have to have a mastectomy for some reason with
secondary current. Is that a reconstructive choice and a good choice for them?
Implant reconstruction post-radiation has, you know, if you look in research papers, anywhere from 20 to 60% chance of infection or failure. And so it's a really high chance. Having said that, we had a whole big debate at the California Plastic Surgery Society meeting a few months ago where at UCLA and other places people still do it, but it's almost like rolling the dice whether or not you're going to have a problem. And the last thing we want is to, on top of everything else, have some kind of infection or issue. So any kind of autologous muscle flap that comes in and brings new circulation into the area that was radiated is really helpful, whether or not you have an implant there as well. So, great.
Okay, I think that some of our panel will stay around and can entertain some more questions. I do want to thank our panel. I also want to mention, I said it takes a village, and as skilled as these people are, they're actually all have colleagues who would be equally as impressive, although maybe not as good looking, if we had them up here today. So we really do have, we're very fortunate in this community to have a very great depth of highly skilled people. So to our panel. Again, I want to thank Mentor for their assistance for today's event and for helping us with the gala. The Women's Council once again, and I want to thank all of you, and don't forget you are all indicated to be very bright by our panel, so thank you. We do have a lot of food, and please stick around. Thanks so much. Thank you.